إن الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل، فقد أمرنا الله سبحانه بذلك في كتابه الكريم، فقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. ثم أما بعد، آسيا عليها السلام, the wife of Fir'aun عليه لعنة الله, she believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the home of someone that said أنا ربكم الأعلى, in the home of a man that said that I am your Lord most high. When news got out of Asiya's iman, Fir'aun began to beat Asiya. And not only did he beat her himself, but he commanded his guards to beat her. And they took Asiya out, alayha salam, in the noon sun, tied her hands and tied her feet, and there they would beat Asiya because she believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. While Asiya was being beaten, do you know who she turned to? Who could she turn to? She turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she prayed, رَبِّ بِنِي لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ, O Allah, build for me a home in paradise beside you. It's narrated that when she said this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the heaven for her so that she could see her place in paradise. And while she was being beaten and she saw this place, she started smiling. And the guards were shocked. They said, how can she be beaten? And she is smiling. And frustrated, Fir'aun commanded them to bring a rock and to crush Asiya alayhi salam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took her back before they could kill her. And she became an example for all the believing men and women till the end of time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا امْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ إِذْ قَالَتْ رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي عِندَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَنَجِّنِي مِن فِرْعَوْنَ وَعَمَلِهِ وَنَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. And Allah has set forth an example for the believers, the wife of Fir'aun, when she said, my Lord, build for me a home with you in paradise, and save me from Fir'aun and his deeds, and save me from the transgressive, disbelieving people. In our lives, we go through two stages. Either what is happening to us is good, or what is happening to us is bad. As a Muslim, when something good happens to us, we have a duty at that point, and that is to do shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this good that is happening to us. And then when something seemingly bad happens to us, as a Muslim, we must have sabr, we must be patient. And with the sabr and with the shukr, the Muslim travels through his life, and through that, there will be no worry for him, insha'Allah ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ, strange is the affair of the mu'min. إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ, everything, all his affairs are good for him. إِنْ أَصَابَهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ, if something good happens to him, he thanks Allah and it becomes better for him. وَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ ضَرَّاءَ صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ, and if something bad happens to him, he is patient and it is better for him. وَذَلِكَ لَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ, and this is only for the believer. Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah ta'ala says that if this dunya was not a station of tests, if this dunya was not a station of tests, it wouldn't be filled with the diseases and the sicknesses that we see. If life wasn't about hardships, then the prophets and the messengers and the pious people would have had the most comfortable of lives. We see the shayateen living these lives, but if this life wasn't about tests, it would be the scholars and it would be the prophets and the messengers that would have the best life. But Adam alayhi salam came out from Jannah and he suffered test after test until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him back. Nuh alayhi salam cried for 300 years. Ibrahim alayhi salam was thrown into the fire and later told to slaughter his son. Ya'qub alayhi salam cried until he became blind. Musa alayhi salam challenged Fir'aun and was tested by his people. Isa alayhi salam had no provision except the things that his disciples would give him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam met poverty with patience. His own uncle Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu was slain and mutilated, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw this and he stood on his body and he said, "By Allah, there has not been a more sadder moment in my life than this life." Sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was the best human to ever walk this earth. And the list of prophets and pious people goes on and on. What happens to us by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a key point of our iman in al-qada wal-qadr is to have rida, is to be pleased with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided for us. And how can we imagine that we're not going to be tested when those who came before us, those who were better than us, they were tested, and they were tested much more severely than the way we were tested. And let us take the example of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Hasan ibn Arafa narrates that after Imam Ahmad was whipped and tortured, he went to Imam Ahmad and he said to him, "Oh Imam Ahmad, you have reached the station of the Prophet. Now, because of this beating and torturing that you've gone through, you've reached the station of the Prophet." And Imam Ahmad told him, "Uskut." He told him, "Be quiet. For verily, I saw the people selling their deen. I saw the people selling their deen, and I saw scholars that were with me selling their deen for this life. So I said to myself," Imam Ahmad said to himself, "Who am I and what am I? What am I going to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tomorrow when He makes me stand in front of Him and He says, 'Oh Ahmad, did you sell your deen like the others sold their deen?'" And Imam Ahmad said that, "By Allah, I thought of that moment, and then I saw the sword and I saw the whip, and I chose them over the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that tomorrow, if I go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I shall say to Him, 'Oh Allah, I was asked to say in one of your characteristics that it was created, but I did not say it.' And then it will be up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to either punish me or have mercy upon me." Rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Hasan ibn Arafa then said, "Did you feel pain from the beating?" And he said, "Up to 20 lashes, he felt the pain, but after that, he had lost all feeling. And in fact, they had whipped him 80 times by the most powerfulest guards that they had." And he said, "That day, I left after the beating, and I prayed Dhuhr standing up." And when Al-Hasan ibn Arafa heard this, he started weeping. And then he said, "Why are you weeping?" He said, "I did not lose my iman, and I did not lose my Islam. Why should I care if I lose my life after that?" This is how they were tested, and these were people that were better than us. Rahimahumullahu ta'ala. Now let us discuss some facts about these tests that we go through in life. First of all, that most of what befalls us from our own sin. Some people, when the sin happens, or when the bad thing happens, they say, "Why this? Why this?" But in fact, because of our own sins that these things happen to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajeem, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُّصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُو عَن كَثِيرٍ." And whatever misfortune befalls you, it is because of what your own hands have earned, and Allah pardons much. Muhammad ibn Sirin used to say, when his death would pile up on him and he would feel sad, he would say, "By Allah, I know that this sadness is coming from a sin that I committed 40 years ago. Rahimahumullahu ta'ala. Because of the small amount of their sins, they knew which sins it was that they were being punished for. رحمهم الله تعالى. But so many of us, our sins have gone so much that we don't even know which sin it was that's causing this suffering. People understand that when something bad happens to them, it is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But brothers and sisters, when something good happens, it is also a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed,
وَبَلَوْنَاهُمْ بِالْحَسَنَاتِ وَالسَّيِّئَاتِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ.
And we tested them with good blessings. And we tested them with good blessings and evil calamities in order that they might turn back, in order that they might come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdul Malik ibn Ishaq rahimahullah ta'ala said, there is no one that is not tested with health and prosperity. No one that is not tested with health and prosperity to measure how thankful they are with those two things. And the companion Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, we were tested with hardship and we were patient. And then we were tested with prosperity and we were not patient. And in this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُلْهِكُمْ أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَلَا أَوْلَادُكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the believers, O ye who believe, let not your wealth or your children divert you from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever does that, then they are the losers. Patience must happen from the very beginning. عند الصدمة الأولى. When the person first hears news of the calamity, patience doesn't happen the day after he is patient or 3 days later. In fact, the patience must happen immediately when the person gets the news of the calamity. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ عِنْدَ الصَّدْمَةِ الْأُولَى. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, verily patience, i.e. is only sabr when practiced at the first hit of the news. أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are things that contradict sabr. And the Prophet ﷺ showed us when he told the people about the wailing that happens when someone dies, for example. And in modern times, people may tear their shirt when they hear of a death, or they'll slap their face, or they'll curse, and they'll wail. Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha narrates that the Prophet ﷺ said, any Muslim that says when a calamity befalls him, that which Allah commanded him. Any Muslim who says this, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, verily to Allah we belong and truly to Him we return. اللهم اخلصني في مصيبتي. O Allah, reward me in this calamity. وَخْلُفْ لِي خَيْرًا مِّنْهَا. And grant me better than it. The Prophet ﷺ said, any Muslim that says this, Allah will grant him better than that which was taken away from him. And these tests are a way that our sins are expiated, a way that our sins are washed away. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha says that fever sheds away sins like a tree sheds its leaves. And it is these hardships that distinguish the believers from the insincere. Shumayt ibn Ajlan rahimahullahu ta'ala anhu says, the pious and the ungrateful are both hidden by health. When health comes, both the pious person and the ungrateful person will be hidden behind it. But when the calamity befalls, those two men are separated by the actions that they take. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أَلِفْ لَامْ مِيمْ أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif Lam Mim, do the people think that they will be left alone because they say, we believe, آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ, and that they will not be tested?
وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ.
Indeed, we tested those who lived before them. Why, you ask?
فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ.
And Allah will certainly make it known the truth of those who are truthful, and will certainly make it known the falsehood of those who are lying.
أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم.
ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وبعد. Ali رضي الله تعالى عنه once stood on the minbar and he called out to the people something that he heard from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said الصبر من الإيمان بمنزلة الرأس من الجسد. Verily, sabr is to iman what the head is to the body. When the head is cut off, the body falls. And then Ali رضي الله عنه raised his voice and he said أَلَا إِنَّهُ لَا إِيمَانَ لِمَنْ لَا صَبْرَ لَهُ. Verily, there is no iman for he who has no patience, for he who has no sabr. The ulama have divided the sabr into three categories. First of all, الصبر على طاعة الله, that there should be sabr in obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a good example of this is Salatul Fajr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to do our salawat and commands us to pray fajr. And the mu'min should not only pray the fajr, but he should have sabr in the prayer of the fajr, and he should have sabr in waking up. And the sabr happens when he is obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second one is sabr an ma'asiyatillahi ta'ala, having patience in not disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'll give you an example of this. When someone, for example, he's traveling or is commuting, and in his commute, he is listening to music in his car. He knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forbidden this from him, and that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has made this haram. But he says, I have no patience, I have to listen to this, or else I'll fall asleep, I have to use my time. This person is not practicing sabr, is not having patience in the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not disobeying Allah. And he should have sabr. And this is one of the requirements of sabr. And the third category is sabr fi qada'i Allahi wa qadari, to have patience in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees upon us. And for example of this, that when someone's child, for example, passes away, that the person should be patient and saying only that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hope for the reward in that patience. Now there are two keys, and if you understand these two keys, then inshallah we will be going on our road to this patience in our life. The first key is that everything that belongs to us, our souls, our wealth, our family, everything, the car that's standing outside, the home that you go to, everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and does not belong to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to us like a loan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He takes back that loan, He is more worthy of it and it belongs to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This did not come to us from something that we did. We had nothing before this ni'mah, and we can have nothing after this ni'mah if we don't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah who gives it to us, and it is that ni'mah, it belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second key is that this is not the place where we are going to be living forever. We are only on a journey. And the place that we are going to be living, the real issue is Jahannam or Jannah, is the paradise or hellfire. And that we have to know that that is where our focus should be, and that should have the first priority before ever anything else. Let me draw your attention to a verse in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
حافظوا على الصلوات والصلاة الوسطى وقوموا لله قانتين.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, guard strictly the five obligatory prayers, especially the middle salah, and stand before Allah in obedience. If you look at this verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, the verses before this verse deal with divorce. And the verses after this verse deal with divorce. And in the middle of these verses that are dealing with divorce, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَافِظُوا عَلَى الصَّلَوَاتِ وَالصَّلَاةِ الْوُسْطَى. Guard strictly your prayer, especially the middle prayer. And the ulama have said, وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ, that perhaps this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in these times of hardship, that the person may forget the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hardship, they may forget the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forget their salah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that it is through this salah, it is through the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, coupled with the sabr, that the person will get through the hardships that they're going. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ.
Allah says, O you who believe, seek help. You're looking for help, seek help in patience and salah. In sabr and salah, truly Allah is with those who are patient. Allah is with them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is good news for those who intend to act upon their sabr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them three things, that His prayer will be upon them, His mercy will be upon them, and He will guide them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, who when afflicted with calamity say, truly to Allah we belong and truly to Him we shall return. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون.
They are those on whom the salawat, i.e. the blessing and forgiveness of the Lord is upon them, and who shall receive His mercy, and it is they who are the guided ones. In conclusion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran,
وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we made from among them leaders giving guidance under our command when they were patient. We made them leaders giving guidance under our command when they were patient. Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah ta'ala comments on this verse in the tafsir, and he says, i.e. when those people took hold of the leading issue, sabr, when they took hold of the leading issue, Allah made them into leaders.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وأنثانا. اللهم من أحييته منا فأحي على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. فأقم الصلاة.